Hi and welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today we'll cover another respiratory disorder that affects children, which is called croup, or this mouthful, laryngotracheal bronchitis, or also LTB. Now, just think about what this means. Laryngo pertains to the larynx, tracheal pertains to the trachea, and bronchioles refers to the bronchioles, and then itis is inflammation. So this is basically inflammation of the upper airway, larynx, trachea, and the upper airway bronchioles. Now then there's a special case, which is epiglottitis. It does fall into these croup type disorders, but it's a little bit different, and we'll discover here why shortly. Now epiglottitis is basically inflammation of the epiglottis, which is the part that closes off the trachea when we swallow and eat. So when there's a lot of inflammation there, there can be a lot of problems. So now knowing that we have upper airway inflammation here, well, first of all, let's go over the causes. So typically croup or laryngotracheal bronchitis is caused by the parainfluenza virus, typically occurs in the winter months, like most pediatric respiratory disorders. Boys are higher, have a higher prevalence than girls, and the age range is usually 6 months to 6 years old. Where epiglottitis is a little bit different, it's caused by a bacteria, which is HIB, Haemophilus influenza type B. And because this is such a significant, or can be such a significant problem with an airway obstruction, we now vaccinate children against HIP. So if the patient is typically on a normal vaccination schedule, then the risk for them to get HIP should be relatively low. But because we're dealing with this upper airway inflammation, signs and symptoms include inspiratory stridor. So this will be the narrowing of the airway that we can hear, and it's typically the sound that's pretty significant, and a lot of times can be heard with just a naked ear without even using a stethoscope. And it sounds something like ee. This sound that's pretty significant and should hint you, give you hints that there's something going on with the patient's airway. Now, because of we have all this inflammation here, the patient might be complaining of a sore throat, they might have a hoarse voice, and then they might have this, and I will put all quotes here, harsh, brassy, croupy, or seal-like cough. So croupy, cough, and that is something also that once you've heard it, it's really very easily distinguishable, and it's very loud, and it does sound like a seal, if you ever heard a seal bark before. A lot of times it'll be accompanied by high fever, agitation, and then any of those signs and symptoms of respiratory distress because the airway might be partially occluded. So nasal flaring or retractions, tracheal tugging, any of those signs and symptoms. Now for epiglottitis, and I have this color coded here, so typically the croup symptoms are in black, and then epiglottitis, whatever is special about that, I put here in pink. So for epiglottitis, we have the four Ds, which is drooling, dysphagia, dysphonia, and distress. So these are a little bit more significant symptoms. And the patient might be drooling because they're unable to handle their secretion. So their airway is so swollen that they cannot even swallow their own saliva, which is definitely a red flag. If you ever see a patient drooling and they can't handle their secretions, there's immediate interventions are needed. So the four Ds here. Then for our diagnostics, so usually croup is diagnosed based on symptoms with this inspiratory stridor, sore throat, and then this typical cough that we usually experience. We are only going to do a nasal swab if the airway is open, so we don't want to put anything in the patient's nose or mouth to even inspect the posterior pharynx if we think that there's inflammation going on or swelling, because we know that children sometimes are not very cooperative with their exam, and even if just a slight touch of the back of the throat or even with a nasal swab can cause some increased inflammation and swelling and completely occlude the patient's airway. So very, very careful here. In the case of suspected epiglottitis, the patient is going to get an X-ray or CAT scan of the soft tissue of the neck to see the extent of the swelling and airway obstruction. They might need a chest X-ray to see if there's anything else going on, if there's suspicion for pneumonia or atelectasis. And if they have epiglottitis, they will usually be admitted, so they'll get some basic blood work, CBC, metabolic plan, as well as blood cultures, because we want to find out if the infection might have been spread systemically. Now, our treatment and nursing care here is pretty self-explanatory. If we have upper airway concerns, we always want to make sure that we maintain a patent airway by whatever means possible, and that includes having intubation equipment readily available at the bedside, because if there's something getting worse, we can't be scrambling for this equipment. We need to have it right there at the bedside. Cool humidified air or oxygen is always a good idea when there's any kind of upper airway swelling, because the coolness of the air and the coolness of the oxygen will help with the edema of the swollen airway. Now, something that we tell parents in the home care of their children, when they have some sort of croup, sometimes it gets worse at night. And so that they don't end up in the ER, or some home remedy that the parents can do is either take the patient outside into the cool air or turn on the shower with cold water only, and that steam that will be coming, although it's only cold water, there will be still some extra moisture and coolness in the air that will help to decrease the airway swelling. Now, certainly, if that doesn't help, then they need to call 911 and go to the closest emergency room to deal with this potential airway obstruction. Children will need to be hydrated because they are drooling, they have dysphonia and dysphagia, they can't swallow, they can't talk, so IV hydration is going to be very important. We already talked about intubation equipment. And then for medications, I'm going to underline this here also. So this racemic epinephrine is a treatment for both croup and epiglottitis. And what it is an inhaled version of an epinephrine. And what it does, it bronchodilates, and it dilates the entire airway, therefore reducing the swelling or the narrowing of the airway, and allows the patient to breathe easier. Now, this medication can only be given at the hospital, and it requires very strict observation of the patient, because when they receive this medicine, they might get better very quickly, and the parents will think, oh, my child is fine, I can go home now. But they might have rebound swelling and rebound inflammation once that medicine wears off. So they'll keep these patients in the ER for 2 to 3 hours after the treatment to see how they are doing. And if they require two or multiple doses of this epinephrine inhaled, then they might need to stay at the hospital for close observation. Now, when there is epiglottitis, then the patient will require IV fluids again, because they're not going to be able to swallow and stay hydrated, and we know that that's a huge issue in the pediatric population, as well as IV antibiotics. Remember, we said it's caused by a bacteria, so the only way to fight that is with antibiotics. And then a lot of times they will get IV steroids as well, or sometimes after the initial period they'll be transitioned to PO steroids, and a lot of times that is dexamethasone. So in summary, just think about where the inflammation takes place. In this case, if it's in the larynx, trachea, or bronchioles, or the epiglottis, we have to worry about the airway because of all the swelling that occurs here. Signs and symptoms are pretty self-explanatory if you know what is causing the problem. So thank you for watching the summary of croup and epiglottitis. Please watch for all of the other pediatric respiratory disorders in the playlist here, and I will see you next time. Thank you for watching Nursing School Explained.